nice to meet all of the interfaith leaders, and you're all seekers of truth and lovers of God. To be the company of the holy people like you is an honor and privilege. As Jesus said, whenever two or more are gathered in my name, I am present there. And that is what our scriptures say. So I know the Lord is present with us and guiding us and blessing us. So the ancient scriptures, one of the oldest scriptures, the Rig Veda, which is one of the oldest scriptures, there is a beautiful saying says, Ekam Sat Vipra Bahudha Vadanti. Truth is one, but the wise people, the sages, call by various names. And this is what all the scriptures say. And Shema Israel, Adinoi Alihem, Adinoi Ilhar. So the who says there is only one God. And I know there is Islamic faith people, what La Ilahi Illallaha Muhammad Rasulallah. So all of them, what they say, there is only one God, He is omnipresent. The way we understand may be different. That is the fundamental reason for these interfaith dialogues we have. I was fortunate enough, even Pope Paul, John Paul, that we had in Los Angeles, they have an interfaith dialogue. I was fortunate to be part of it. It's wonderful to see that all of us on the same goal. Paths may be different. The goal is the same. That is where the summarization of Bhagavan's teachings can be summarized with all this. He says, there is only one religion, religion of love. And there is only one language, language of the heart. And there is only one caste, caste of humanity. And there is only one God. He is omnipresent. That is what, when we practice love, then we are religious. So important is love is the underlying principle. There is only one religion, religion of love. And even when we talk about there is only one language, language of the heart, I traveled around the world, many parts of the world, and we meet so many people where sometimes language barrier is there. But we can feel through their gestures, through their language of the heart, how they are expressing their love for us. So this is important to realize there is only one language, language of the heart. But how do you put into practice? I think nobody would object to say the two basic tenets of all our spiritual practices is love and service. That is why we chose this topic. Love is the source, love is the path, and love is the goal. It's what did Jesus said when he was asked, Master, what is the first and greatest commandment? He said, love thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind and strength, and love thy neighbor as thyself. That is the greatest and first commandment. What is our wonderful Saint Paul said, the favorite apostle? He said, you may have a faith to say a mountain to move, it may move, but if you do not have love, it is of no use. You may talk in various languages and may prophecy, you may know scriptures, if you do not have love, it is of no use. You may give everything you have in charities, but if you do not have love, it is of no use at all. So he said, beautifully summarized, faith, love and hope are great. Of all, the greatest is love. That is the power. That's why even Islam, it is considered the reason God created, Allah created the world because of his love. That's why Sai Baba beautifully said, I separated myself from myself so that I love myself. This whole creation is the projection of the love. That is why a beautiful example is given by Baba. If you want to see the moon, how do you see the moon? Through the help of the moonlight. You don't need a torch or a candlelight to see the moon. Through the moonlight you see the moon. Similarly, God, who is the embodiment of love, you can experience him only through love. That the love is the source and the path and the goal. That's why Baba beautifully says, God is love, love is God, live in love. Start the day with love, fill the day with love, end the day with love, and this is the way to God. That is why Bhagwan Baba, in his life, he has shown his life, his message, his ideals, humanitarian works, all in one word, is love, love, love. He is an incarnation of love. He has shown how to live the path of love. So, but how to love? We use this word very glibly, love, love, divine. Here you are talking about divine love in contrast to worldly love, which changes from time to time. So the divine love knows no boundary. This transcends the barriers of caste, creed and religion. It is unconditional, it is pure, it is eternal. In contrast to worldly love, where you give and take, always conditional. What do I get from it? But as divine love, the love you experience from great master like Buddha, Jesus, Muhammad, or Sai Baba, Ramakrishna, this is a love which is unconditional, pure, unsullied love. But to experience that love, how do we experience that love? And they have given beautiful messages. You cannot serve two masters. Lord Jesus said, you cannot serve God and mammon. So if you want, you should have the highest priority to God in your life. That's why Swami said, you cannot ride on two horses. What happens if you ride on two horses? You will fall down. So you should have that one-pointed love for God. You should give priority to God in life. That's why somebody said, how do you get joy in life? J, Jesus first. O, others next. Y, yourself last. So you should give highest priority to God in our life. That's why beautifully Jesus said, seek ye the kingdom of God, everything shall be added unto you. If you have kingdom of God, everything is there. And Sai Baba made it beautiful. In simple words, he said, in the world, like your family is like a zero. Your job is a zero. Your education is zero. Your bank balance is a zero. They're all zeros. But you put God in front of that, it becomes millions, billions, trillions. But if you don't have that one, any number of zeros is zero. That's why first we give priority to God in life, then our family, our bank balance, our job, everything has importance. That's why Swami says, without God you are a zero. With God you become a hero. So that's why we should give first priority to God in life. But sometimes we get mixed priorities. Baba has given a beautiful example. For most of the people in the world, like houseflies. What does housefly do? Sometimes it goes and lands on nice, beautiful dishes, and other times it goes and lands on garbage. So that is, and then what about honeybee? Honeybee would go and go only to the nectar of the flowers. He would rather die, but it won't go anywhere else. Similarly, in the world, there are two kinds of people. People who have come to go to the church, the temple, synagogue, and then other time they go party and spend time in sensual pleasures. That's called real life. That's what, like living like a housefly. But there are people like honeybees. What all they want is, they want to talk about God, listen about God, work for God. Their life is filled with divinity. So that is the life you lead, then God's grace and blessings will pour. That is the kind of intensity. That is why the great saint like Ramakrishna Paramahamsa of Dakshineshwar said, who cries for God? People cry for wife, wealth, job, everybody cries. But who will cry for God? If you really shed tears, Lord, I want you and you alone, nothing else. God will be, feel his presence all the time. That is the kind of intensity we should have for God. That is the love. That is the real love. And love should be love for love's sake, not to get something in return. That is the love God has, and he expects the same thing. You love him because you want to love him. That's it. There's no ulterior motive. I know in the beginning stages, there's nothing wrong to pray to God for our health, wealth, family. But real love, the great saint said, love for love's sake. That is the kind of love we should try to experience. And there are so many sages and saints like that who have lived that kind of love. But this love is not just to be talked in words. It should be expressed in actions. That is service. Service is nothing but love in action. So beautifully, Jesus, one time he was asked, Jesus tells them, when I was hungry, you gave food to me. When I was thirsty, you gave drink to me. When I was naked, I didn't have clothes, you gave clothes to me. When I was sick, you visited me. When I was in prison, you came to see me. Then they asked, Lord, when did we do this to you? Then he said beautifully, when you do anything to the least of your brethren, you do it to me. So whenever we serve anybody in the world, and our Baba said, even not only human beings, any being in the world, you serve, it goes to him. He says beautifully in Sanskrit, Sarva Jiva Namaskaram Keshavam Patigachiti. Whatever adoration, whatever service you do any being in the world, it goes to the Lord. With that kind of attitude. That's why Jesus said, whenever, whatever you do to anybody, it comes to me. That's why Baba said beautifully, the hands that serve are holier than the lips that pray. So service is love in action. So, but how do we do this service? And when we do service, the attitude is very important. There are so many people who do service, but the attitude with which we do the service is very crucial. So that's why this word is used in our organization by Baba. We call the service not a seva. Seva is Sanskrit word for service. It's called Narayana Seva. That means we feel that when you are serving, you are really serving the Lord. You are not serving somebody. So when you think you are serving the Lord, if Jesus is in front of you, or if Muhammad is in front of you, or Lord Rama is there, Sai Baba, how do you, if it will give anything like that? You do it with humility and reverence, with bent knees you offer to them. So important, if you really convince you are doing service to the Lord, you are doing love and humility. That's very important. Ultimately, when you go on doing the service with this attitude, what happens is, this is the beautiful thing, the culmination. When really God is giving you opportunity to serve, whenever God gives opportunity, we grab that opportunity to serve. But if we have a clear understanding, God is the one really doing the service. So God is serving to God, the mechanism of service. So ultimately all the three become one. God is serving God through the process of service. That kind of attitude we should have. And when we do service, we should have ready to sacrifice. God doesn't look at the quantity, how much you gave, with what heart you have given. That is why when the old woman goes to the temple in Jerusalem, and she puts that old lady 2 pence in the coffers, and Lord Jesus says, she gave more than all these rich people have given, because she gave what little she had. She sacrificed that. There are people like that who do the sacrifice. Like Baba has built a beautiful hospital in Puttaparthi. People there, philanthropists, wealthy people, generous people, gave millions of dollars when they were constructing. But Baba appreciated that. But he recognized in public, in the veranda, I was sitting there, a young boy, student, who gave only 100 rupees. He put it, with humility, he put in a cover and gave to Baba. And he showed, because this boy, he saved that 100 rupees, which is nothing but a couple of dollars, saving his pocket money, which was sent by his parents, instead of giving his clothes for the washerman, he did it himself and saved that money. And he, with humility, he wrote to Baba, Baba, please use this money for your hospital. He was so shy, he didn't want anybody to know. But the proud father, the divine father and mother, who can recognize purity and love, he recognized that and tried to show to people, see this boy, he recognized that more than millions of dollars which was given. And same thing Jesus, and same thing Lord Buddha, when there was a wealthy king wanted to give lots of gifts to him, Lord Buddha said no, and he took from a old woman just a basket full of fruits. So God looks at the heart with what we do. And what is the ultimate purpose of service? This is beautifully said. There is a word, in Sanskrit it is there, we call volunteers. There is a word which is used called Swayam Seva. That means we serve ourselves. When we serve the other person, remember that we are getting the opportunity given by God for our own transformation. This is for our transformation. We should remember that. This is for our purification of heart. Really the test that we are really doing good service or not is this. How purer we are, how humbler we are, we have less ego, are we less jealous, less angry. Still we are angry, we are jealous, whatever service you do, that means what service we are doing is not benefiting us at all. If you are a spiritual seeker, if you want to know the truth, you want to realize that you are the embodiment of love, main thing is always self-audit. How am I progressing? Am I really getting purification of the heart is the sine qua non of wonderful service. So main thing is we should try to get rid of our egoism that we are the doers. Second thing is we should get rid of the identification with the body and also get rid of these negative qualities like anger, jealousy, attachment and hatred. That is what each one of us will know. If you are treading on the right path, then you will become pure. And what did Jesus say? Blessed are the pure in heart, for they shall see God. So if you are pure, then automatically you will have vision of the divine. That is why Baba said a beautiful message. Purity is enlightenment. The minute you are pure, you are enlightened. You don't need to do any other spiritual practices. All our spiritual practices are to get this purity and enlightenment. So that is what these wonderful people, there are people who do so much service with this attitude. So these are the two basic principles with which you do, we receive the grace and blessings of Baba. Then, once we do this, once we are pure, we all realize we are the children of the same God. Our paths may be different. That is the problem. Right now in the world, there are so many wars. I don't need to tell you, religious intolerance. People cannot tolerate. But we should realize we are all the children of the same God. That's why I said, whether the Jewish statement or whether Hindu scriptural statement or Islamic statement, they're all say this. There's only one God. That means we don't believe when we fight among ourselves. That when you have children in the family, if your children fight the father and mother, will they be happy? They won't be. Here our divine mother and father, who is only one for all, if he fight, he won't be happy. So that is why tolerance of religion is very important. That is the first step, tolerating the other religion. But you need to go higher up. That is, see the unity of faith. Think there is only one faith, there is only one religion, religion of love. This may be the different aspects how you look at it. So that is the attitude we should have. Not only we should tolerate others' religion, but we should embrace the goodness of all religion. Because all the teachers said same thing. Every teacher said, love all, serve all. Nobody said against that. So we need to see the unity of all faith and harmony of all religions. That's why Baba, when he came to East Africa in 1968, what a beautiful discourse he said, let all faiths flourish. Let everybody sing the glory of the Lord in their own language, in their own particular way. It is important, if you are a Hindu, become a better Hindu. If you are a Muslim, be a better Muslim. If you are a Christian, become a better Christian. If you are a Jew, become a better Jew. Whatever faith you are following, be intense and sincere in that and you reach the same goal. Then you will see the unity and diversity. The whole problem for us, all these difficulty, challenges we have, we see diversity, different colors, different races, different faiths, different beliefs, but you should see there is only unity. Unity in diversity, once we experience, we'll always have that joy and bliss. I will end with this quotation of Baba, which is very beautifully said. He says, nations are many, but earth is one. Stars are many, but sky is one. Jewels are many, but gold is one. Parts are many, but clay is one. Flowers are many, but worship is one. There is, see that unity in diversity, then we will see only oneness and we will be joyful and blissful. I pray to the omniscient, omnipresent, omnifelicitous Lord to bless us all so that we pursue this path of truth and love, so that we love all and serve all. This is the greatest maxims of our organization, which I want to share with you. And I thank the organizers for this wonderful meeting. And now I would like to hear from our other leaders the various different views. That's why Baba says a diamond gets more luster and beauty the more cuts it are, more facets. So you try to enjoy God in different ways. So for example, there is bread, the same old bread, you know, you want sometimes toast bread or a white bread, yellow bread, same thing, rice. Similarly, God, you want to enjoy in different ways. You should not say only this is the only way to worship God. God can be worshipped in as many ways as there are human beings. So main thing is we have the purity and love for God. Thank you very much. Jai Sai Ram.